from our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
My message is going to be brief, and my text is going to be Luke, the 23rd chapter, beginning at verse 42. Remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. The greatest and most historical event of all of history was when Jesus Christ died on that cross. And when Christ died on the cross, the lightning flashed, the thunder roared, the darkness came. As the nails had gone into the hands of Christ and a spear had gone into his side and the nails through his feet, and Jesus was hanging between heaven and earth, suffering for us. The soldiers had taken him out of his prison and they'd put a crimson robe on him. They'd beaten him two or three times. And then they took two or three murderers with him, two of them in particular who were going to be crucified with him. And then they took him across Jerusalem and they made each one of them bear a placard, or at least a herald went before them to bear a placard telling of their crimes. And then Jesus stumbled and fell. He was weak from the loss of blood, and they compelled an African to help him carry his cross. And as long as the history of man shall go, we will always remember that it was an African that helped Jesus bear his cross. There are people today that say that Christianity is the white man's religion. Don't you believe it? For all of those who believe in Jesus Christ, he belongs to all people. He came from that part of the world that touches Asia, Africa, and Europe. He belongs as much to the African as he does to the European, and as much to the European as he does to the Asian. Jesus Christ belongs to all people, but an African helped him carry his cross. And then when they got to Golgotha, these soldiers went about their work, nailing the nails in. These two murderers and thieves that were being crucified with Jesus were yelling, screaming, crying, but Jesus never uttered a word. And they took some medicated wine that acted as a sedative and gave it to the two thieves, and they took it and they offered it to Jesus, and he refused it because he wanted to drink the very bitter dregs of death in our place for us. He wanted to suffer all of death, showing that God loved the world and God was willing to forgive the sins of the world because of what Christ was doing on that cross. The people that were watching were laughing and sneering. They said, he saved others. Why can't he save himself? Come on, you worked great miracles. Why don't you work one more? You raised Lazarus from the dead. You raised a widow's son from the dead. Why can't you save yourself? Those blind people did not realize that God had foreordained and predetermined that Jesus Christ was to die the death of the cross. And it was only through that death that the world could find forgiveness and salvation. There is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. The Apostle Paul was an intellectual, one of the most brilliant men that ever lived. And Paul went to Corinth, pagan, intellectual, immoral Corinth, the university center of the ancient world. And Paul said, I'm determined to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Why did Paul say that? He said that because God has locked up in the cross the secret of the universe. The only way that earth can ever find reconciliation with heaven is by way of the cross. The only way that you can ever get to heaven is by way of the cross. And if Jesus Christ had not gone to the cross, you could have never had sin forgiven. You could have never gone to heaven. And the problems of earth would have never had a solution. Only by the way of the cross can we find our way back to God. And that's why it was important that Jesus stay on the cross. Because you see, man is in rebellion against God. Adam and Eve rebelled in the Garden of Eden. And every man since Adam and Eve has broken God's law and sinned against God. And as a result of that, God and man are separated. And man's only way back to God is through Jesus Christ. Man had broken the law. Man deserved death. He deserved judgment. He deserved hell. But God said, wait a minute. I'll give my son. I'll let him die. I'll let him take the judgment and the hell for you. And if you will put your trust and your faith in my son, I will forgive your sin. I will change your life. I will give you an inner peace and joy and satisfaction that you would never find in any other way. So Jesus was dying on that cross for your sins and your sins. Some people say, why don't you try to make your gospel relevant? The most relevant message in the world tonight is the fact that Christ died for you. He died in your place. He shed his blood for you. And without that experience, no one can get to heaven. Yes, Jesus Christ died, and the people laughed and sneered. And two people that sneered and laughed the most were these two thieves and murderers that were dying with him. They were both mocking him, but one of them became strangely silent. And finally, this one that was silent turned and rebuked the other thief and the other murderer and said, we're dying justly. We deserve to be crucified, but not this man in the middle. He's a good man. He's the Son of God. Then he turned to him and asked him what seemed to be an improbable, an impossible question. He said, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Will you remember me, Lord? And then Jesus gave one of the most astounding answers in the history of the world. The angels in heaven must have been shaken and startled and amazed when they heard what Jesus answered. Jesus said, today, today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. Think of it. Here was a thief, a murderer, a man that had committed every crime in the books, dying, turns to Jesus in his dying moment and says, Lord, remember me. He didn't even say, forgive me. He didn't even say, Lord, take me to heaven with you. He didn't say, Lord, prefer me. He just said, Lord, remember me. And Jesus answered quick as a flash and said, today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. And to all of you people that think you can't be converted in a moment and that you cannot be saved at this hour and at this moment in this rain in Baton Rouge and have your whole life transformed, you read the stories of the New Testament and the encounters that people had with Jesus. There are many of you that came here tonight in this rain that never dreamed that you were going to meet Jesus. You came out of curiosity, or you came because your bus was already on the way, or you had already promised some friends to come, or you're a student here at the university and you came out of curiosity. Many of the people of the New Testament that came to Jesus never planned it. They never thought that they would have their lives changed. This thief on the cross that had been in prison knew that he was going to die on a cross. He knew he deserved it. He never dreamed that before the night came, that day, he would be in heaven. He deserved judgment. He deserved hell. I'm going to see that man in heaven someday by the grace of God. He wasn't saved by his good works. He didn't even have time to be baptized. He didn't have time for anything. But he's in heaven. That's the grace and the mercy of God. And I want to tell you that the greatest word in all the language of men is forgiveness. That day, Jesus forgave him of every sin he had ever committed, wiped the slate clean, and he was in heaven. There are three things about this passage. The whole gospel is in it. There's repentance. It's the only deathbed repentance in the whole Bible. I don't know what led this fellow to ask that question or to make that statement. It might have been the prayer that Jesus had just prayed, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. It might have been what Jesus had said to John concerning his mother. I don't know what it is or what it was, but the Holy Spirit used it. The Holy Spirit used it to convict him and to convince him that he needed Jesus, and he repented of his sins at that moment, and he was saved. I can imagine the other thief saying, why, what have you done? Have you turned preacher or something? You remember we strangled that old merchant for his gold? Remember you kidnapped that little child? Remember that girl you raped? Remember that person you slew? You think God's going to forgive you? Are you turn a preacher? He can't forgive you. I don't care what your sin is. I don't care how deep in sin you've gone. I don't care what you've done. God can forgive you. God can cleanse you. God can make you a new person tonight if you put your faith and your trust in him. Yes, he repented. And the second thing he did was to believe. The Bible says if we believe in our heart that God hath raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. The scripture says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Just repent and believe, and then you'll be saved. He said, when thou comest into thy kingdom, as though he were thinking of some far-off kingdom age somewhere. And Jesus answered and said, today, right now, you'll be saved. Right now, you can have eternal life. You can put your trust and your confidence in Christ now. And he did. And that day, he went to paradise. Now, it's the word remember that I want you to think about a moment. He said, Lord, remember me. Did you know that God forgets? Did you know that there's a scripture in Jeremiah 31, 34 that says, I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sins no more? God can forget. God can forget your sins. What does God forget? God never forgets the universe. He sends the rain. Yes, sir, God sends the rain. But the rain falls on the just and the unjust. The sun comes upon the just and the unjust. God blesses all of us with all of his blessings. He never forgets. Suppose he forgot to send rain. Suppose the sun ceased to shine, the earth would turn into a glacier. Suppose God would forget. Because the scripture says that God holds the whole universe together. And if God ever took his hand off, it would blow to pieces. And then the scripture says that God remembers you. Tonight, I had in my little office here where I see people, a lady and her children and a mother and their son and their husband is a prisoner in North Vietnam. I don't think any of us will ever know what these families have suffered. I don't think any of us will ever know what those boys out there have probably gone through psychologically and physically, never knowing. And then we had another one come and see us tonight, and her husband, she's just found out, is alive and a prisoner, but for a long time she didn't know. He was only missing in action. But let me tell you this, God remembers them. And when we bowed our heads in the little office and prayed that God would remember them and that His grace and His love would reach out to North Vietnam, to the prison camp, and touch them, God remembers them. And God answers prayer. How many times has God been with you? You don't even know. Because you see, you almost had a wreck the other day. But you were saved from it. Why? When you get to heaven, you may find out why. It might have been divine intervention. And that happens to all of us. God remembers you. And then God never forgets our sins either. The Bible says, be sure your sin will find you out. The Bible says, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. The Bible says, for God shall bring every work into judgment. God is going to judge every sin that's ever been committed. What is your sin that so easily besets you? It's going to be brought to light, all the secret things. God is going to judge it. God never forgets sin. No sin has ever been forgotten by God. God has recorded everything you've ever done and all the things you've ever thought from the time you were born till the time you die. It's all there. It's all in the record books, and God will never forget. Nothing is going to be forgotten. How do you stand before God? But there's one thing God can forget. He can forget sin because of Christ. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, He hath made Him to be sin for us. It says in Isaiah 53, the Lord hath laid on Him the iniquity of us all. It says in 1 Peter 2:24, who His own self bare our sins in His own body on the tree. The Scripture teaches that God can forget our sins because of Christ. The sin that would damn us, the sin that would send us to judgment, the sin that would send us to hell, God can forget. In Hebrews 1:3, it says your sins are purged. In Isaiah 43, it says your sins are blotted out. In Psalm 103, it says your sins are put away. Isaiah 38 says your sins are put behind His back. And in Hebrews, it says God can remember your sin no more. Ladies and gentlemen, because Christ died, because He rose again, because of what He did, God cannot remember my sin. I've committed plenty of sins in my life. And even if I'd only committed one sin in my whole life, it's enough to cause me to go to the judgment and be lost. Because I could keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, and I'd be guilty of all. But God has forgotten my sin. He forgot every sin that I have ever committed. Everyone He has forgotten. He's the only person in the whole universe that can forget. He has the ability to forget. Has He forgotten your sin? Have you brought your sin and laid it at the feet of Jesus? What a night to give your life to Christ. You may never have another moment like this. The Bible says, he that hardeneth his heart, being often reproved, shall suddenly be cut off, and that without remedy. You've sat here for over 2 hours in the rain. Many of you are soaked all the way through. And you've done it because you want your sins forgiven, many of you, and others of you have sat here because you're praying for somebody that needs Christ. And this is your hour and your moment, and it may never come again like this. I'm going to ask you to do something that I saw people in London do. I saw people in San Diego do. I saw people in Pittsburgh do. I'm going to ask scores of you to get up out of your seat right now and come across this field in the rain and stand here and by coming say, I want Christ in my life. I want my sin forgiven. I want to know I'm going to heaven. I want to know that I will not be at the judgment in that final day. I want my life transformed by the power of Christ. I'm going to ask you to come right now. Men, women, young people, God has spoken to you. You need Christ. And in a moment like this, you'll never forget it. I met a missionary out in the Far East a few months ago. Said, I received Christ one of those nights at Wembley Stadium in the pouring rain in England and stood ankle deep in mud to find Christ. And said, I thank God because if it hadn't been for the rain, I don't know whether I would have come that night or not. But he said there was something about the challenge of coming forward in the rain that challenged me, and it changed my life. Yes, it's not easy to come, but Christ went to the cross for you. And many people are on the way now. You get up and come and make your commitment to Christ.
As hundreds are responding to Mr. Graham's invitation to make a public commitment to Jesus Christ, you can make that same commitment right where you are. Just pick up the phone and call the number you see on your screen. Special friends are waiting to talk with you and pray with you about this most important decision.
To all of you that have come. You've come tonight to make your commitment to Christ because you want your sins forgiven. You want to know you're going to heaven. You want a new direction in your life. And you've come to make a commitment to Christ because you want Him to forget your sin and save your soul. Well, I want to tell you, He remembers you and He loves you and He wants to forgive you. He loves you. Keep that in mind now, that God loves you and is willing to forgive and forget all the past. And from tonight on, there are four things that are very important. First, read your Bible every day. We're going to give you a Gospel of John. We want you to read it several times before you read any other part of the Bible. We're going to give you a Bible study. We're going to give you some verses of Scripture to learn, memorize. This helps you to grow. Desire the sincere milk of the word that ye may grow thereby, the Scripture says. You cannot grow in the Christian life without reading and studying the Scriptures every day. Secondly, pray. God will hear and answer your prayer. You're His child now. He loves you. Take every detail to God in prayer. He will answer your prayers. Don't let a day go by but what you spend a few minutes every morning, every evening, and all during the day in prayer, and pray about everything. Whatever the details are, nothing is too small to bring to God's attention. And then thirdly, witness for Christ. How do you witness? You witness by the smile on your face. You witness by the new attitude you have in the dormitory, the new attitude you have toward work, the new attitude you have in the home. And then you witness by going to somebody of another race and going out of your way to be kind and courteous and gracious. And people will soon say, well, what's happened to you, Mary? And you can say, well, I've found Christ. He's changed my life. That's witnessing. And then fourthly, get into a church where Christ is preached and get to work for Christ. Get into the church and work in the church. You say, but I don't like to go to church. Jesus went to the churches of His day and they weren't all they were supposed to be. But He did it to set us an example that we should go to church. Four things: read the Bible, pray, witness, and go to church. Now I'm going to ask that we bow our heads and I want you to pray this prayer out loud after me. Oh God, I am a sinner. I'm sorry for my sin. I'm willing to turn from my sin. I receive Christ as Savior. I confess Him as Lord. From this moment on, I want to follow him and serve him in the fellowship of his church. In Christ's name, amen.
If you just prayed that prayer with my father, or if you have any questions about a relationship with Jesus Christ, I would just call that number that is on the screen. There'll be someone there to talk with you, pray with you, and answer those questions. And remember, God loves you.
If you would like to commit your life to Jesus Christ,
from our archives, the Billy Graham Classics.
Now tonight, I want you to turn with me to the 12th chapter of Matthew. The 12th chapter of Matthew. And beginning at verse 38, somebody asked me what version I'm using. I'm using the same one Paul used, the King James Version. You know, we have so many versions today that you can stand up and quote scripture, and if you misquote it, they think you're using another version. And it's very interesting. I guess my wife and I must have 25 different versions. Well, I'm going to the King James Version as I normally do in my preaching. I like a number of the versions, and they throw a lot of light on it. And I heard the story that someone told about Timothy had received a letter from the Apostle Paul. And behind him were two donkeys loaded down with baggage, and they said, "What is all that?" They said, "Well, these are the commentaries to tell you what Paul is saying in that letter." Then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, "Master, we want to see you do a sign. We want a sign." But he answered and said unto them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall be no sign given it but the sign of the prophet Jonah." Isn't it strange that Jesus would use Jonah? He didn't tell us not to believe the story of Jonah. He accepted the fact that Jonah had been swallowed by a whale or a ship, or a big fish. "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." He was using that as an illustration of his own death and resurrection. "The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, a greater than Jonah is here." Remember when Jonah preached to Nineveh? And Nineveh was a great city of several hundred thousand people, and the greatest revival of all time took place when that entire city turned to God in repentance. They repented of their sins, and everyone in the whole city turned to God. And God spared that city the judgment. And I've been praying for America. Oh, God, spare America. Because we see the possibilities of our world being destroyed, not only in atomic war, but also by AIDS and other things that are gripping our world at the moment. "The Queen of the South shall rise up in the judgment with this generation, and she'll condemn it. For she came from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. But behold, a greater than Solomon is here." How could a greater than Solomon ever come? I want to talk about that tonight. I want to use Solomon's life as an illustration of the lives of Americans today and American young people. Because you see, Solomon was a man of great knowledge. And we look on every hand today and we see young people seeking knowledge, security, love. It seems that they're on a great quest. Young people seek to define themselves in terms of clothes they wear. And we hear that the miniskirt is on the way back. And the crowd they run with, and the things they buy, and the places they go, and the rock concerts they attend. But many of our young people today are lonely. And I was talking to the dean of one of our great Eastern universities, and I said, "What is the greatest problem on this campus?" He said, "Lack of purpose and meaning." That was Dr. Bach at Harvard University. Now, the results of Solomon's search were expressed time after time. He said, vanity of vanities, life is nothing but a vanity. And the word vanity means a bubble that burst. He sought pleasure by every conceivable means, but it was nothing but a bursting bubble. Solomon had it all. And at the end, he said, it's not worth it. First, Solomon attained great knowledge. He knew more than any man that ever lived except Jesus Christ. He said, I've gotten more wisdom than all they that have been before me and all of those that are going to follow me, in Ecclesiastes 1:16. In 1 Kings 4:30, it says, Solomon's wisdom excelled the wisdom of all the East and all the wisdom of Egypt. He said, I gave my heart to know wisdom, and I perceive that this also is vexation of spirit. For in much wisdom and knowledge, there is much grief. He said, you can know it all. Have all the knowledge and have all the PhDs and all the rest, but it doesn't satisfy something deep inside our hearts and our souls. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. And the struggle intensifies around the globe right now for the hearts and minds of youth. But Christ said we're to love God with our heart, soul, strength, and mind. And you cannot come to God alone through your mind. Our natural minds have been affected by sins. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:14, their minds were blinded. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them that believe not. The God of this world is the devil. The Bible teaches there is a devil. There are demons. And they have the power to blind your mind towards spiritual things. In the futility of their thinking, they are darkened in their understanding, says Paul in Ephesians, the 4th chapter. Now, that's the New International Version, by the way, that particular scripture I just quoted. Now, the Bible teaches in Titus 1 that our minds are defiled. In Daniel 5, it says they're filled with pride. In 1 Timothy 6:5, it says they're corrupt. In Ephesians 4, it says they're filled with vanity. In Proverbs 21, it says they're wicked. With all of our stockpiles of knowledge, do you know what we've learned? We've learned something that Adam and Eve did not know in the Garden of Eden. We've learned the knowledge of evil. Adam and Eve gained the knowledge of evil when they sinned against God. God never meant that we were to know what evil was. He created us perfect human beings. We were to live thousands of years on this planet. We were to build a wonderful world with God's help. But we rebelled against God, and we gained the knowledge of evil. And now we've reached the point in civilization where, with all of our knowledge, we have now invented the atomic bomb and the hydrogen bomb and chemical weapons and computers and all the rest that make it so that man can be wiped out in a matter of hours. What can we do? Receive Christ. Let Him dominate your mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. The Scripture says you can be transformed in your thinking. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Give your mind to Christ. Yes, there's going to be peace because Christ is the Prince of Peace. He's going to bring peace. But only through God are we going to find peace. You can have peace in your heart right now. You can have peace of mind right now by surrendering your life and your heart to Jesus Christ. The Bible says God made the wisdom of this world look foolish. The world failed to find Him by its wisdom, and He chose to save those who have faith in the folly of the gospel. Notice He calls the gospel folly. The gospel is folly to this world that has its mind blinded and affected by the devil. You see, sin is a disease. It's also a disease of the mind. It's worse than Alzheimer's disease or any other disease that you can think of. It's destructive, and we all have it. The Bible says all have sinned. What can we do about it? Come to the cross. Let Christ forgive your sins, change your life, turn you in a new direction, and give you a new mind, because Christ can become the Lord of your mind as well as your body and as well as your soul. And then Solomon was not only the smartest man and the most brilliant man that ever lived and the best educated, but he gave himself to great pleasures. In Ecclesiastes 2:1, he said, I said in my heart, go to now, I will prove thee with laughter, therefore I'm going to enjoy pleasure. He had every sensual pleasure that you can imagine. The Bible describes in details all that he had. He had the finest swimming pool you've ever read about. It was flanked by 12 lions of gleaming bronze. He drank the finest wines in golden goblets. He had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Talk about sex. He had it. More than any of you will ever have. And every pleasure that you could think of was at his beck and call. He did what many of you would like to do, but you can't afford it. Some people are good because they can't afford to be bad. But God doesn't count that. Some sin is expensive. With every imaginable device of pleasure and lust at his fingertips, Solomon sat out under the stars one night and contemplated the emptiness of it all. He said, vanity of vanities, it's all vanity. It's a bubble that burst. How many of you are crying tonight on the inside? On the outside, you have a mask. Inside, the peace and the joy and the happiness that you've always searched for is missing. Something's wrong in your marriage. Something's wrong in your courtship. Something's wrong in your school. Something's wrong in your life. Something's wrong between you and your parents. Something's wrong between you and your friends. Something's just missing in your life. Do you know Christ? Do you have the joy and the peace that He can bring? Because in Him are the pleasures that you can have. And then Solomon was the richest man in the history of the world. His income was staggering. It's all listed in the Bible. The weight of gold that came to Solomon in one year was 603 talents of gold. That's billions of dollars. Did you know he had a stable of 40,000 horses? But one night he sat on the top of his house in Lebanon. And with indigestion, his hand clutched at his empty heart, and he said, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. It's all a bubble that burst. It's nothing. All this pleasure, all these riches and everything are nothing. The Bible says in Psalm 37, a little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked. I'd rather be as poor as Job's turkey and know Christ than to be the richest man in the whole world without Christ. In Proverbs 23, he wrote, wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings, and they fly away like an eagle. Jesus said, beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. And we look on Wall Street. Sometimes they show those pictures of those men going crazy. Just, I don't know how they keep up with it all. But people go crazy over money. And even poor people long for money. They say, if only I had a few thousand dollars, I'd be happy. No, you wouldn't, because you'd want a few thousand more. And then Solomon had great power. Men like power and prestige. And no nation of the world of that day dared defy Solomon. He had more power than any man of his generation. He had the greatest army, he had the greatest navy in the world of that day. And he looked upon his mighty military power and he said, it's all a bubble that burst. What shall it profit a man, Jesus said, if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Suppose he had all the knowledge and all the wealth and all the power in the whole world today and lost your soul. And many of you are doing just that. You've gained in your circle of world. You've gained all that you can gain, but your soul you're not sure about. You go to church. You have a name on a church roll. You've been baptized and all of that. But deep in your heart, something is missing. You don't know what it is. The thing that's missing is that personal relationship with Christ. But Paul talked about another power that comes. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. And then so Solomon turned to the aesthetic life. He said, well, maybe I can do some other things that'll bring happiness and peace and joy to my life. He said, I made pools of water. I got me men singers and women singers and the delights of the sons of men as musical instruments. He got orchestras and he got ballet. He got everything. And whatsoever my eyes desired, he said, I kept not from them. I had everything I could ever think about or desire, but he said it was all vanity. He developed a love for art and music and culture. He built beautiful gardens, had musical recitals. Then he said, I looked upon all the works that my hands had wrought and on the labor that I had labored to do, and behold, it was all vanity and vexation of spirit, and there's no spirit under the sun, no profit under the sun. You see, if you had it all that you're striving after, it wouldn't bring the peace and the happiness you're looking for. Why? Because it's found in Christ. The scripture says, behold, are greater than Solomon's. And now Solomon also tried religion. He vowed to build the greatest temple that the world had ever seen. Solomon's temple took 7 years to build, and it was called one of the seven wonders of the world. His temple was an architectural wonder. It was made ready at a quarry so that when it was built, they didn't use any hammers or axes or any tools of iron was heard while it was being put together. It was so perfect. He overlaid the temple with pure gold. The floor was made of gold. It took 150,000 laborers working 7 years to build it. But religion without a personal encounter with Christ will not save the soul. It won't bring peace to your soul that your soul longs for. Where is peace? Where is fulfillment? Where is life's purpose and meaning? Finally, Solomon came to this conclusion. He said, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment, whether every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. In other words, he said, there's a judgment coming, and to be prepared for that judgment is the most important thing in the whole world. Come to the cross. That's the only place you can find forgiveness. And Jesus said, behold, a greater than Solomon is here. Jesus said, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus said what we see on that sign, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the embodiment of all truth. Think of a man standing in front of the world and saying, I am the embodiment of all truth. He's either crazy, or he's lying, or he's what he claims to be. Jesus said, I am the truth, and I can set you free. Free from your anxieties, free from your troubles and problems. I can give you a peace to go through them. Now, he doesn't take your troubles and problems away, as Dawn told us a few moments ago, but he gives you a peace and a joy that will enable you to go through them and live through them if you put your trust and your faith in him. Yes, Jesus was greater in wisdom. It says, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. It's in Christ. In Colossians 2, in Jesus Christ. If you know Christ, you know more than the professor at the greatest university, because that professor is looking for something that you found. Christ was greater in giving pleasure, because the scripture says in Hebrews 12, who for the joy that was set before him. You see, when you receive Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live into your life, and he produces in you joy. It's supernatural joy. And there's pleasure beyond anything that you ever dreamed in Jesus Christ. I remember my mother was dying a few years ago up here in Charlotte. And the last words my mother was heard to say was in a loud voice at 5 o'clock in the morning. She'd been in a coma. She hadn't said a word, she hadn't moved, and she was a great woman of God. But she suddenly sat up in bed, the day she died and shouted out, Psalm 149:5, let the saints be joyful in glory and let them sing upon their beds. Can you imagine that? I think she was already in heaven. In 1 Peter 1, it says, whom having not seen ye love, in whom though ye now see him not, yet believing you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. In thy presence is fullness of joy, at thy right hand there pleasures forevermore, the Bible says. Psalm 16:11. Do you know that? Do you know that kind of joy? That's something that's supernaturally produced. You can't find it anywhere else. You can't find it in sex experience. You can't find it in drugs. You see, the whole country is on a quest for something. In drugs, in sex, in entertainment. We want something. We don't quite know what it is. And it's elusive. We don't find it. Oh, you can go out and have a good time at a party, and prom is going to be around the corner. You can have a great time on your prom night if you get the right guy. But something will be missing. All of a sudden, in the midst of a crowd, in the midst of a dance, in the midst of the orchestra playing, in the midst of the band playing, your face will suddenly have a little cloud over it, just for an instant. It's just a moment in which it seems that it's not all put together. The puzzle is not put together. And then you forget it and you go on. But it's there, and it'll grow through the years. He was also greater in riches. It says, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. There's no riches compared to the riches in Jesus Christ. Come to Christ, and he gives you the real things of life. And then he was greater in power. It says all power is given unto him in heaven and earth. And the Bible says that someday he's going to come back in power and great glory, and his holy angels with him. No wonder the Apostle Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Do you know that power? Has that power come into your heart? Have you received him? I'm going to ask you tonight to make sure of your relationship with Christ. I'm going to ask you to enter into his force and march under his banner, under his flag, and say, from this moment on, I'm following Christ, like Dawn said a few moments ago. Do you know him? Are you sure of it? I'm going to ask you to come and stand in front of this platform and say, by coming, I want to come to Christ with all my heart. I want to surrender to him. I want to make sure. You want to receive him into your heart, or you want to rededicate your life to him? You get up and come and stand here. And after you've all come and stood here, I'm going to say a word to you and have a prayer with you, then give you some literature to help you in your Christian life. You say, well, why do you ask people publicly? Well, the reason I ask people publicly is because every person that Jesus ever called, he called publicly. He hung on the cross publicly. He said, if you will not acknowledge me before men, I'll not acknowledge you before my Father which is in heaven. The scripture also says, he that hardeneth his heart, being often reproved, shall suddenly be cut off, and that without remedy. You may never again in your whole life have a moment like this tonight. What a gorgeous evening. There may never be another moment when you're so close to the kingdom as you are tonight. And the Bible warns time after time, now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. You have no promise of tomorrow. You have no promise that your heart will be feeling the way it feels tonight. God is speaking to you. You're making a choice tonight. You're making a choice between Christ and all that the world has to offer. And you're saying, Lord, I'm putting you first from this moment on. I want to get in on your side. You get up and come right now, hundreds of you. Now to you that have been watching by television, you're seeing that here in Columbia, South Carolina, in this great football stadium at the university, there are hundreds of people that are making their commitment to Jesus Christ. Many of them young people, finding purpose and meaning in their lives and direction in their lives. They're choosing Christ. I'm asking you to make the same choice wherever you are, in your hotel room, in your home, wherever. Give your heart and your life to Christ where you are. And pick up the telephone and call that number on the screen. There are people standing by to talk to you.
And as hundreds are making their commitments to Christ here at the Williams-Brice Stadium in Columbia, South Carolina, you can make your decision for Christ right now. Mr. Graham has already encouraged you to make that telephone call. We hope that you will. Special friends are standing by, ready to talk to you.
California school teacher, the mother of six children, was kidnapped some time ago by five drug addicts. She was stabbed 20 times in the back. Her captors told the police that they were warlocks, that is, male witches, and that they were devil worshippers. In Montana, some time ago, a 22-year-old social worker picked up a hitchhiker near Yellowstone National Park, and the hitchhiker then shoots his victim in the head, brutally attacks the dead body, and tells the police that he worships the devil. In Miami Beach, a 69-year-old retired woman is viciously attacked by a young woman who later tells reporters very happily that for the last 5 years, she has been worshiping Satan, and this is her sacrifice to the devil. Story after story after story like that could be told tonight if we only had time to tell it. The scripture has a great deal to say about the devil and demons. In fact, the whole Bible is the story of a conflict between the forces of God and the forces of the devil. And the scripture I would like for you to turn to is Deuteronomy, the 18th chapter, two verses, the 10th and 11th verses of Deuteronomy. There shall not be found among you anyone who maketh his son or his daughter pass through the fire, or who useth divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter of mediums, or a wizard. You remember the story of Saul. He broke that law of God. He had lost contact with God. God had left him. No more blessing upon Saul, the great king of Israel. And so he decided that he was going to consult a medium and try to get a message from Samuel. He consulted the medium. He was successful in talking briefly with Samuel, but he was killed shortly thereafter as the judgment of God fell upon Saul and his family. Now, Americans at this hour are vacillating, according to the latest polls. Some deny the existence of the devil altogether, but others have an unnatural fascination with the devil and with demons and with exorcism and other things in the occult. And because of the success of The Exorcist and many new films are being made on the subject of the devil and evil right now, a pastor who saw one of these films said recently, it was obnoxious, repulsive, disgusting, pornographic, and obscene. I myself have not seen any of these films. I do not intend to expose myself to this type of thing. But a Jesuit priest who saw one But a Jesuit priest who saw one of these films said in his survey among university students, most students that have seen the films wish they had never seen them. Now, this is not a phenomenon just in America. It's also in Germany, where there are thousands of witches. It's also in Great Britain, A British bishop said the other day that Great Britain is turning to black magic as their interest in Christianity declines. And I believe that one of the problems in the world today that is not recognized is the great intensification and acceleration of evil in the world at this moment, because the devil knows his time is short. The coming of the Lord Jesus Christ may be drawing near. And the scripture teaches that as the coming of the Lord draws near, the activity of the devil will intensify. The kidnapping, the violence, the terror all over the world, I believe, is a part of demonic activity. One authority says that witchcraft is growing faster than any other religion in the Western world. And one reason I think that young people get involved is because it does get them involved. It's a return to nature, in a sense, a worship of the natural gods, finding some power within themselves or broadening their minds, some of them through drugs and some without drugs. But thousands of young and old alike are dabbling in the occult at this moment. Shops in our cities are selling all types of things that go along with the occult. One university professor, not this university, but a university professor said some time ago that there were dozens of covens on their campus. Now, coven, as you know, is a circle of witches and warlocks are male witches, numbering 13. They always number 13. And they have their rites and their rituals and their literature and their witchcraft. Now, what is right and what is wrong? What is false and what is true? The Bible has a lot to say about it, and I'm going to cover a big subject in a very few minutes tonight. First, the Bible teaches there is a devil. There is a devil. We meet him in the third chapter of Genesis, and we don't get rid of him till the end of the book of Revelation. He's all the way through the Bible. And in the Bible, we find that he's a person. He walks, he talks, he tempts, he lies, he flatters, he kills, he works miracles, he counterfeits, he oppresses, he afflicts, he influences, he destroys, he quotes and misquotes scripture, he possesses, he inflicts bodily injury, he sows discord in the church, he spreads false doctrine. Those are the things that this personality in the Bible called the devil does according to the scripture. Now, he's called in the Bible, he's called Satan, he's called the devil, he's called a fallen angel, he's called a roaring lion, he's called the prince of demons, he's called a wolf, a prowler, Beelzebub, the dragon, the serpent, Lucifer, a great light, a star, a betrayer, an adversary, a wonder worker, a liar, the father of lies, the god of this world, the prince of this world, and the prince of the and power of the air. His is described in the Bible as the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of evil, the kingdom of unrighteousness, the kingdom of hatred, sin, death, hell, and the grave. He produces false miracles, false spiritual experiences, false tongues, the father of fakery. He has a false church, a false gospel, a false plan of salvation, a false trinity, false preachers, false prophets. That's what the Bible says about the devil. Now, the word Lucifer means light bearer, one who shines. It's a deceptive light. It's not the true light. It's a deceptive light. It's a false light. He promises freedom, liberty, and light, but he produces only sorrow, slavery, and death. He's a deceiver, and he's trying to deceive thousands of you young people tonight by promising you that if you'll only follow him and serve him and bow down to him and live for him, that he will give you freedom, liberty, and in life. But actually, he gives you sorrow, slavery, and ultimately eternal death in hell. Now, the devil is resisted in the Bible by the characters of the Bible that God honored and blessed and loved. He was resisted by Job. He was resisted by Jesus. He was resisted by the disciples. He was cast out of heaven. And the Bible says he will eventually and ultimately be cast into hell, the lake of fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels. Now you say, how did the devil originate? Why did God allow the devil? Well, there's a lot of uncertainty about that. The Apostle Paul calls evil the mystery of iniquity. There are just some things we don't know. God did not reveal it to us. And if God did not reveal it to us, we shouldn't be delving into speculation. But there are some hints in the Bible about where the devil originated, in Isaiah the 14th chapter and Ezekiel the 28th chapter. In the 14th of Isaiah it says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cast down to the ground? For thou hast said in thy heart, and then it says five times, I will, putting his will against God's will. Listen to it. I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. In other words, there came a time somewhere back in eternity when Lucifer, the highest and greatest of all of God's created beings, led a rebellion against God. And it seems that about a third of the angels joined him in the rebellion. They were cast out of heaven. They landed on this earth. And the devil and these fallen angels who have now become demons are active on this planet. They're under judgment. They've been defeated by the cross and the resurrection. They are ultimately going to be cast into hell. But in the meantime, they are active and increasing their activity. Now, the sin of Lucifer was pride. He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be above God. He wanted to be the greatest being in all the universe. So he led the rebellion. You say, where did he get this idea? We don't know. How did sin enter his heart? We don't know. Why did God allow him? We don't know. This is wrapped up in the mystery of God. It's wrapped up in the mystery of iniquity. It's something we don't understand. And it'll never be resolved until the Battle of Armageddon, when our Lord Jesus Christ is going to come back, followed by thousands of the armies of heaven, and he's going to destroy forever the devil and his angels. And we'll be rid on this planet of the greatest plague and the greatest thing that has ever happened to any planet anywhere in the universe. Now the second thing, what about demons? The New Testament makes one thing clear. There's one devil, there are many demons. You remember the story in the fifth chapter of Mark, the man of the Gadarenes? This man was possessed of a devil, many demons. And it had affected his mental, his emotional, and his physical faculties. And Jesus held conversation, not with the man, but with the demons. Jesus never talked to the man at all. He talked to the demons. And there are several things about that man that interest me today and are relevant at this hour in America. He was naked. He was a shrieker. He was violent. He was violent. And look at the violence in the country. And he wanted the demons to be cast, or the demons wanted to be cast into the swine, into the pigs. You see the combination you have here? You have violence, nakedness, self-destruction, and pigs. What do some of the people call the police today? Some of the more violent people. Pigs. Is there a connection? I don't know, but it's quite interesting that this demon-possessed man that Jesus encountered would have all of those things that we're wrestling with today. Now, the origin of demons, as I said a moment ago, is unclear. Jesus said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. And the Bible says in Revelation 12, the devil and his angels fight against Michael the archangel and his angels. Now you say, what about exorcism? Well, do you know what the word exorcism actually means? The word exorcism means expelling spirits by a religious act or religious service. That's how what it means, expelling an evil spirit. And Jesus, of course, was the greatest of all exorcists. He commanded the demons and the forces of evil to come out of people. And that man that I was telling about a moment ago, he commanded this legion of demons to leave, and they left and went into the swine, and the swine went hurtling into the sea and destroyed themselves. Now, the fact of exorcism is a reality, but it's misunderstood. Some of the modern interpretations originated actually in pagan practices. Magic formulas and rituals to expel evil spirits have been practiced for centuries in primitive societies, usually accompanied by violence and infliction of pain. There's one tribe in India that I read about where they take a cotton wick soaked in oil and they light it and they stuff it up the nostrils of the person who is supposed to be possessed of demons. And the cruelty of professional exorcists in many parts of the world is beyond our comprehension and understanding. Now, Matthew, the 8th chapter, tells us that when the disciples brought to Jesus many that were demon-possessed, he cast out the spirits, not with a long ritual, as we're being told today, but by a word, his word. And his disciples cast out demons, how? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, by a word, the power of the name of Christ. And Mark 16:17 says, and these signs shall accompany those who have believed in my name. They shall cast out demons. However, there's a warning. Don't go around using some sort of hocus pocus and say, be gone in the name of Jesus. It won't work. You have got to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and you have to be walking in the Spirit, and you have to know that that's a demon, and you have to know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you have the authority of God's word back of you. Behind the name of Jesus stands the power of Almighty God. Now, how do you keep from being possessed or harassed and vexed by demons? You see, demons have power only, that is, as far as a Christian is concerned, only when you are walking in some sin. If you allow a besetting sin to get a grip on you, you've opened the way for the demons in your life. As we walk with Christ, if you're a Christian and you're walking in the Spirit and God is with you and all known sin has been confessed and you're in fellowship with Christ, then you can walk in the middle of the most dangerous spiritual situations and be protected by God. You can claim authority over the devil and his angels. But I'll tell you what the devil will do. He'll bluff as far as he can. He'll take all the ground that you give him. Give him an inch, he'll take a foot. A woman possessed of the spirit of divination, you remember, bothered Paul in Philippi. And he said, you evil spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of this woman and leave her alone. And the evil spirit came out. Now, I personally have had that experience a few times, but very few. And I was trying to think, only once in America I remember twice in India. I remember once in Africa and once in the Far East, twice in the Far East. And on each occasion, very interestingly, the person involved used the same three words. I am free. Christ can free you. But it's not done with a ritual. It's not done with the way it's being depicted. It's done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And every believer, every Christian, has the right to pray that prayer with a person who is in trouble. Now, a great many things that we call demon possession are not demon possession at all. For example, mental problems are not caused by demons. Some may be, but many are not. And so you have to have discernment that only the Holy Spirit can give you as to what is demon activity and what is normal activity or the activity of nature. You say, well, how do we overcome demons when they bother us and harass us? I want you to listen to this. First of all, be sure you know Christ. I do not believe that a true believer in Jesus Christ can be possessed by a demon. You can be vexed by a demon. You can be harassed by a demon. But I do not believe the scripture teaches you can be possessed by a demon. Now, Satan filled Judas. Satan filled Ananias and Sapphira, who were professing believers. We're told in scripture. But are you sure that you know Christ? Do you know that Jesus Christ lives in your heart? Have you settled it? Come to Christ tonight while you can. As Bill Cepeda said he did 5 years ago. As Mike said he did 3 years ago. Come to Christ. Surrender your life to Him and make sure about that. And you will have a power living in you that is greater than he that is in the world. You will have the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of God in your life. And you can resist the devil, the Bible says, and he will flee from you. The second thing, be filled with the Holy Spirit. The scripture says, be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to ask you tonight as a believer, are you filled with the Holy Spirit? You can be filled not through some emotional ecstasy. You can be filled by a simple act of faith. How did you receive Christ? You received Him simply by faith. All right, you're filled the same way. You can say, I am filled by the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, by faith. You see, the moment you receive Christ, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your heart. And as you surrender everything that He points out that's wrong in your life, then He fills you, and you're filled, and you produce fruit. Now, every Christian has the gifts of the Spirit. You have a gift. I don't care who you are and how lowly a Christian you are, you have a gift. And you ought to be utilizing that gift in the body of Christ, and you ought to be utilizing that gift in witnessing for Christ. But the fruit of the Spirit is something different. The fruit of the Spirit is different than the gifts of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is produced by the Holy Spirit, love and joy and peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and so forth. That's produced by the Holy Spirit. Now, if you are living in the Spirit, producing the fruit of the Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, Satan cannot get inside of you at all. But let me tell you, sin, even the slightest little sin, will grieve the Holy Spirit and open the way for demonic activity. Jesus said, I will never leave you nor desert you. I will not forsake you. Now, the third thing, watch for the schemes of the devil. The scripture says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Now, the devil is going to exploit your personality quirks, the lust of the flesh, the natural physical drives that you have, hunger, as he did Jesus. He tempted Jesus when Jesus was hungry. The devil always comes to you when you're weak to tempt you, to harass you, to trouble you. Watch out for those moments when you're weak, when you're hungry. He also uses the sex drive. Sex is a powerful drive that we all have, and the devil will use it if we give him a half an inch. For our struggle, the scripture says, is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the powers, the world forces of this darkness, the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. And the scripture says, therefore, take up the full armor of God, that ye may be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. And then the Bible outlines the armor that we should have. And I want to ask you tonight, if you have your armor on, have you checked it? First, check it. The belt. Paul said, having your loins girt with truth. Now, the belt or the girdle was a belt about 6 or 7 inches wide that went around a Roman soldier. And by the way, when Paul was writing this in Ephesians, he was in a Roman jail and a Roman guard was guarding him, so he just looked at his uniform and got his illustrations for how we Christians ought to be. And one was that belt, because you see, that belt or that girdle held everything else in place. And Paul says, have your loins girt with truth. In other words, learn the scriptures. Learn the word of God. That's the reason when people come forward to receive Christ, we give them a Bible study and we get them involved in the scriptures, reading the scriptures, memorizing the scriptures. This is how we resist the devil. When Jesus Christ was tempted of the devil, what did he do? Argue with the devil? No. He resisted the devil by quoting scripture. That's all he did. Just quote scripture. He said, it is written. And when he was finished quoting the scripture, the devil would leave him and angels would come and minister to him. And then Paul said, put on the breastplate of righteousness. Now, the breastplate was made of bronze backed with tough pieces of hide. And the breastplate of righteousness is what we get from Jesus Christ when we come to him as our Lord and Savior. Because our righteousness, our goodness, is filthy rags in the sight of God. So you need a righteousness that has been provided for you, and it was provided for you by Jesus Christ on the cross. And we receive the breastplate of righteousness so that when the devil shoots his fiery darts, they can't penetrate that breastplate. And then thirdly, he says, how about your boots? Having your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Now, that doesn't mean to go out and just preach the gospel. It means more than that. It means that you should have the peace of God in your heart. The serenity, the joy, the happiness that Christ gives should be in your heart, so that when troubles come, Satan will not be able to get close to you. You see, Satan uses worry, anxiety, and tension to keep us off balance. Are you afraid? Do not fear, for I am with you, says God. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will uphold you with my right hand, says God in Isaiah 41. Are you worried about inflation? Everybody is. Bills are stacking up, pressures of business closing in, children getting out of hand. Are those the things you're worried about? The scripture says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all comprehension, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And then fourthly, what about the shield? The Roman soldiers carried a shield. The scripture says, in addition to all, taking up the shield of faith with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming missiles of the evil one. Now, Roman's shield was 2 feet wide and 4 feet long, and it warded off the blows of the enemy. He would hide behind it when arrows would come against him. Satan is always shooting his missiles and his darts at us. We need the shield of faith. Trusting, believing in God, taking God at his word. And then fifthly, there's the helmet. and take the helmet of salvation. The helmet is very important because it guards the brain, protected the head. There's a lot in the scripture to say about the mind. Let this mind be in you which was in Christ Jesus. That will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Intellectually, you cannot come to Christ alone because your mind has a veil over it put there by the devil. But when you come to Christ, your mind is illuminated by the Holy Spirit, and the things that you didn't understand before, you now accept by faith, and you put on that helmet, and that helmet protects you against the enemy. The devil is going to try to cause you to doubt. He's going to try to cause you to question. I remember my own father. He had been told by a preacher many years ago that he'd committed the unpardonable sin, and my father thought all those years that he couldn't come to Christ. He hadn't committed it. He didn't even know what it was. And it was years later that he found the joy of his salvation again. You see, Satan had sidetracked and perverted the scriptures. And then there's the sword, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That's the offensive weapon. You see, a Roman's blade was about 24 inches long, and he would twist and turn, keep his balance always, thrusting. And the scripture says that the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. When Satan tempted Jesus, Jesus used the sword, the Word of God. That's the reason it's important to study the Bible, to know the Bible, to learn the Bible. And I believe this. I believe that Christians and believers are going to go through a period of trouble and difficulty. We may go to jail. We may be killed for our faith, as many people in other parts of the world have been. We're not going to escape. It's on the way. And the way to get prepared is to learn this book so that when they do call upon you to witness, when they do call upon you, you know the scriptures. And you can quote the Word of God and be a witness and resist the devil. And the scripture says he will flee. And then the seventh and the last thing is to pray. Pray without ceasing, said Paul. With all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit. Praying and Bible study. Check your armor. Is it in place? One final word. The final victory. The devil and his works and death and hell and the grave have been nullified. They've been destroyed by the Lord Jesus Christ at the cross. The victory is won. The victory is assured. Till that final day, there's a lot of suffering, a lot of fighting, a lot of battling, but we're on the winning side. And the scripture teaches that Jesus Christ has won the victory. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. By the blood of the Lamb. There is power in the blood.